Yeah, my last class, I had started discussing the push-pull converter. I told you that the push-pull converter is used for high power applications. For medium power, forward converter is still attractive. What is the limitation of a forward converter? One of the limitations is that the source does not supply power to the load during the time allowed for core reset. And the flux is either positive or zero, unidirectional excitation. So in the BH characteristics, operation is always in the first quadrant. So we can say that magnetics is not well utilized. How do I improve the utilization? To improve the utilization, I need to reverse the flux in the core. But how should I do that? Because input is DC, it's a DC to DC converter. Answer is very simple. If I can increase the flux in the positive direction, somehow I have to reverse the flux and do the same thing in the negative direction. So what I'll do is I'll use a center tap winding. See, as shown here, I'll use a center tap winding. Okay, see the dotted polarities. And I'll connect the supply here and two switches, T1 and T2. So when I close T1, current enters the dot. So direction of flux. Whereas when I close switch T2, see, current leaves the dot, So whatever that happens in N1, happens just the opposite in N12. See, positive is applied to the dot, positive terminal of the battery is applied to the dotted polarity. Whereas here to N12, negative of the batteries that is applied. So definitely direction of flux produced when current I1 is flowing is opposite to that of the flux produced by I2. Okay. Now the direction of flux has reversed in the core. In other words, I can say it's the AC flux. I have used a transformer. So voltage induced in the secondary also will be AC. Please, when I'm saying AC, it doesn't mean that it's a sinusoid. It only implies that average value of the wave voltage is zero. That's all, nothing else. Now, voltage induced in the secondary winding is AC. As I said, it's a DC to DC converter. So I have to rectify it. Okay. There are various ways to rectify AC voltage. Simplest way is use a center tap winding and two diodes. Or use a bridge. At that time, I don't require a center tap winding. So the advantages and disadvantages of using a center tap winding and two diodes and using a bridge, I already discussed in AC to DC conversion. They are still valid here. Okay. Now let's see how this circuit works. T1 and T2 are complementary. Switching signals for T1 and T2 should be strictly complementary. What happens if there is a some overlap? I will discuss sometime later. So when I close T1, okay, current enters the dot in the primary in N11. Okay. So current enters the dot, the right direction in the secondary is to leave the dot. So current leaves N21. In other words, D1 gets forward biased, or D1 starts conducting. See, N11 and N21 is same as the forward converter operation. Recall the forward converter operation. I close T1, current enters the dot. In the secondary, diode also started conducting and power is transferred to the load. So N11 and N21 is nothing but a forward connection. Okay. So voltage induced or voltage applied to N11 is VDC. So voltage that is induced is in N21 depends on the turns ratio. So when T1 is on, what is the voltage that is appearing across T2? Or in other words, what is the voltage rating of T2? I said primary is a center tap winding. So N11, number of turns in N11 winding is same as N12. Okay. So voltage that appearing across T2 is twice the VDC. See here, equivalent circuit I have drawn somewhere here. VDC negative, see dot is positive, so dot is also positive here. So voltage that is applied to N11 is VDC, so N12, voltage induced in 112 is also VDC. See V12, that is nothing but VDC itself. So voltage that is appearing across T2 is VDC plus V12, that is nothing but twice VDC. So remember, voltage rating in a push-pull converter, the device that is used in a push-pull converter is twice the supply voltage. So when the primary is energized, in the secondary current flows through D1, D2 is off. See, this operation of this part is same as that of a center top transformer used in AC to DC conversion. D2 cannot conduct. Okay. Again, voltage rating of this diode is twice the voltage induced in either in N21 or N22. Okay. Now, after some time, T1 is opened. In fact, T1 is opened at dt by 2. Okay. Now, what happens? Flux in the core should be continuous. When T1 is closed, primary has the magnetizing current plus the equivalent load current, or in other words, Im plus I2 prime. So when I open the switch, Im should be continuous. So when I close the switch, current enter the dot. You recall the operation of forward converter. See, I have drawn the forward converter here for convenience. So in the primary, when I close the switch, current enter the dot. So when I open the switch, the right direction for flux continuity is that current in the tertiary also should enter the dot. Current in the tertiary should also enter the dot. Now come back to push-pull. Magnetizing current should be continuous. So when I open the switch, what happens in the secondary? I said current was entering the dot when I had closed the switch in the primary. So the right direction for the flux to be continuous is that current should enter the dot in any one of the windings. That can happen in the secondary in N22 only. Okay, current can enter N22 and leave through D2. Okay. So if D2 turns on, or if this winding starts carrying the magnetizing current, flux will be continuous. But then there is another problem. See the secondary, we have a center tap winding. Current enters the dot in N22. So the moment D2 starts conducting, in the upper half, even D1 starts conducting. Okay. So therefore, when I open the switch in the primary, in the secondary, both D1 and D2 starts conducting. Okay. So you see the circuit equations are here. Okay. See, dot terminal here, dot here, so the voltage induced. So N21 d5 by dt is the voltage source with a positive terminal. Similarly, N22 d5 by dt positive here. I am taking a small resistance, winding resistance into account, and I will apply KVL. What KVL gives? For the upper loop, the KVL is N21 d5 by dt minus R into ID1 should be equal to VO1. In the second loop, it is ID2 into R plus N22 d5 by dt is equal to minus VO1. See the two loops. See direction of current and the two voltage induced voltage sources. So these are two equations. Now N21 is equal to N22, that is equal to N2 by 2. Okay. So I'll add them, add these two equations, and I'll get this equation. We know that when I close the switch in the primary, flux in the core increases. So therefore, when I open the switch, flux in the core should decrease. I have an equation here, N2 d5 by dt is equal to minus of ID2 minus ID1 into R. In other words, N2 d5 by dt should be negative. When can it be negative? It can happen only when ID2 is higher than ID1. Okay. And it is, entire magnetizing current is flows through N22, and the load current IL gets divided into two parts. Half the inductor current starts flowing through N21 and the remaining half starts flowing through N22. So the magnitude of current when you open the switch in N21 is IL by 2, whereas in N22 is IL by 2 plus the magnetizing current. By the way, magnetizing current is not the same magnitude that was flowing when the switch was closed in the primary. It is a reflected current, please. It is a reflected current. Okay. So, in fact, ID2 is higher than ID1. Now, when both the switches are conducting, what is the voltage drop across the secondary, or what is the voltage across the secondary winding? So this is the voltage across the secondary winding, N2 d phi by dt. Id2 minus Id1 is nothing but the magnetizing current, equivalent magnetizing current. R winding resistance is very small. So in other words, voltage across the entire secondary is zero. Voltage across the entire secondary winding is zero. So if the voltage across the entire winding, secondary winding is zero, by transformer action, voltage across the primary winding, the induced, should also be zero. Okay. In fact, this is an approximate sign, not a semicolon, this is an approximate sign. Id1 approximately equal to Id2 is equal to IL/2. Okay. Now I have this equation, I will substitute in this N21. What do I get? Since winding resistance is very small, I can say that VO1 is also 0. Okay. I will substitute this, whatever that I get in the last equation, in the first equation, and I will solve for VO1. I will find that VO1 is also very small, in fact it is 0. So VO1 is nothing but the voltage across N21. If that is 0, the voltage across each half in the primary is also 0. Okay. So this is about the operation of the push-pull converter. Remember, when I close the switch, only one diode is carrying the current. So when I open the switch, both the windings in the secondary, or in other words, both the diodes starts carrying the current. Okay. So in the process, how do I derive the transfer function for the push-pull converter? So when the switch is closed, I said this power circuit looks similar to that of the forward converter. Okay. When I close the switch, both the diodes are conducting. So therefore, VO1 is 0. So if VO1 is 0, what KVL gives for this loop? It is nothing but voltage across the inductor is minus VC. It is VL is equal to minus VC. Okay. So by equating the voltage across the inductor when the switch is on and when it is off, I can derive a transfer function. See here, VDC N2 by N1 minus V0 is the voltage across the inductor when the switch is closed, okay? Because at one end of the inductor we have VC, or we have a capacitor with V0. In other end of the winding is voltage induced in the secondary winding. And when the switch is opened, both the diodes starts conducting, so VO1 becomes 0. So voltage across the inductor is the capacitor voltage itself, there is nothing but V0. So this is nothing but this same waveform we had for a forward converter. But the only difference here is, see, we have dt by 2 and t by 2, wherein forward converter we had dt and t. Okay. I will equate it and I will get a transfer function. See here, VDC N2 by N1 into D, where same as forward converter, where D is the duty cycle of each switch. each switch. Remember, each switch is nothing but T on divided by TS by 2. TS by 2. Duty cycle of each switch. So instead of using this definition as D, I'll use this definition. D is equal to T on by TS. Then I'll get V naught as this. V naught as this. Twice VDC into N2 divided by N1 into D. So this is the transfer function for a push-pull converter. I'll just show the current waveforms also. See here, load current or ID2, the same as inductor current, increases linearly when the switch is on. Okay. Flux in the primary increases linearly. Again, maybe starts from 0. Okay. At this point, switch is opened. Inductor current starts decreasing, maybe. But immediately, see the current ID1 and ID2. ID1 falls to IL by 2 and decreases. ID2 increases from 0 to IL by 2 plus IM dash plus IM dash. Okay. So it continues till you close T2 again. Okay. So when you close T2, whatever that happened during T1 will happen here. Will happen here. Okay. Now immediately diode D1 turns off, entire IL starts flowing through D2. In fact, this is IL. See, there is a jump here. The jump here. This jump is nothing but IL by 2, supposedly, maybe. Okay. So, I will not discuss too much about push-pull converter compared to flyback and forward. Push-pull converter is bit difficult. So, I will not go into detail. Okay. I'll just tell you the limitations of a push-pull converter. What could be the limitations of a push-pull converter? We have in the primary a center tap winding. Okay. Whatever that happens when you close T1 happens just the opposite when I close T2. Okay. To have symmetrical flux waveform or BH loop transition, I need to have identical turns in the primary, in the N11 as well as N12 turns. See here. So, number of turns in N11 should be same as that of N12, and the saturation voltage, in other, when the device is conducting the voltage across the device, should be the same. If they are not the same, what will happen? Voltage that is applied to N11 may not be the same as N12. So what happens? The value of flux that is established in the core when T1 is on may not be the same in the negative half, in the negative half when you close T2. So in other words, I have an average value of flux in the core. A DC flux exists in the core. Because I am applying two different voltages for the windings. Or in other words, in the transformer theory, in AC excitation, I have a sine wave whose halves are not symmetrical along the x-axis. That it amounts to a DC flux in the core. That's a DC flux in the core. Okay. So it may so happen that when I or during overload or sudden change in load, the controller says that increase the value of D. Okay, controller has given a command to increase the value of D. There is a DC flux. It may so happen that core may be driven into saturation. Okay. So protective circuit should be very fast. The moment the circuit identifies a core saturation, immediately it should block the gate pulses for the devices. Otherwise, devices will get damaged, because once the core is saturated, current is limited by the winding resistance. Okay. What is the next limitation? I said in the beginning, the switching signals for T1 and T2 are complementary. In fact, there has to be a dead time. In the sense, you turn off T1, wait for some time, and then you turn on T2. Okay. You cannot, the moment you turn off T1, you cannot turn on T2. They cannot be strictly complementary. There has to be a dead time. A dead time in the sense that during that time, none of the devices in the primary are on. Okay. So because if there is no dead time and both the devices are conducting simultaneously, I said number of turns in both the halves is the same. I'll assume the leakage also to be the same. In other words, self-inductance of the upper winding is same as the self-inductance of the lower half, and that is equal to the mutual. What will happen now? The flux produced by the upper half opposes the flux produced by the lower half. Net flux in the core is zero. Now the current is limited by the winding resistance. Okay? Because there is a cancellation of flux. So VDC is equal to I into R. R is very small. So, you know, devices may get damaged. Okay. So this is what I have explained here. So there is a dead time between T1 and T2. If both are on, flux produced by I1 and I2, they oppose each other. Okay. I am assuming, of course, invariably it is true, because I have a perfect winding with a center tap here. So N11 is equal to N12, so I can safely assume that self inductance or L1 of this is equal to L2, that is equal to the mutual inductance. Then the current in the core when both the switches are on is limited by R. Okay. So one should be extremely careful in designing the gate drive circuit for a push-pull converter. What could be the another limitation? Or another limitation could be voltage rating of each device is twice the supply voltage, minimum voltage rating. Minimum voltage rating of T1 and T2 is twice the supply voltage. So that is the reason push-pull converter is generally used for low voltage, high current power supplies. Okay. Because voltage rating is higher, as the voltage rating increases, you need to choose a device of higher voltage. And it is invariably, our experience is that it is easier to handle a higher current than a higher voltage. So push-pull converter is suitable for or generally used for low voltage, high current DC power supplies. Okay. So that is about the push-pull converter. Yeah, over the years we have seen power conditioning move from the early stage linear regulators through relatively low frequency pulse width modulated systems to high frequency converters. Okay. So these high frequency converters pack the same power handling capability of earlier designs into a size which is much smaller than the earlier ones. So, in other words, the size of a high frequency power conditioning equipment is much smaller compared to that of our earlier designs. Take for example the UPS that is generally used in our homes, how heavy it is, UPS or inverters. Same UPS we are using in the labs, they are so small. Maybe 5.5 kV inverter or 5 kV UPS which is used in a lab, I may be able to hold in my palm, so light. Whereas it will be difficult for me to lift a 0.5 kV UPS which is used in my home. Okay. So if you see the history of power electronics development till the 1960s and earlier, we had systems with linear regulators. They were highly inefficient, larger in size, but then very simple to design and maybe to operate also. Okay. Then afterwards we had systems with switching regulators. They use relatively larger size of LNC. A large number of ICs were required to control these regulators. Okay. Now, what is the reason of reducing the size of the present day UPSs to such a smaller size? That's because we have almost a new technology, what is known as the resonant power conversion. Now, before going into resonant power conversion, I just try to tell you what are the disadvantages of the control technique that we used so far. Okay. Take for example a boost converter. Okay. What happens when I close the switch? Whatever the current that is flowing through L starts flowing through S. Okay. If the current is continuous, instantaneously S has to carry that current, and when I turn it off, the current instantaneously becomes zero. In addition to the inductor current, even this diode has to recover, and the diode recovery current also starts flowing through S. okay. So when I close the switch, di by dt, the rate of change of current that is flowing through S is very high. Okay. Also, there is no way I can control the rate of decrease of voltage across the switch. Okay. So basically, this type of switching is known as the hard switching. Why is hard switching? Because I do not care what is the voltage across the device or what is the current through the device. Whenever it has to be turned on, it is turned on. Okay. So as a result, the stress on the device di by dt, it has to carry instantaneously, it has to carry the inductor current as well as the diode recovery current. Di by dt is very high. Okay. See the locus here, the hard switched device. When I turn on, initial just prior to turn on, current is 0, so it starts increasing. Okay, voltage also starts falling and takes this path. I have explained this while covering the devices. Okay, I'm just redrawing further. Okay, and when I turn off, this is the path. Now, it is possible to control the rate of rise of current as well as rate of rise of voltage across the device by connecting an external snubber, a passive snubber, okay, or lossy snubber. Okay. So this is the path 3. While turn on, while turn off, this is the path. So what happens? The instantaneous power loss that is taking place in the device is high. See, here is it. I'll just show you. See. Voltage across the device is falling, current is increasing. So voltage across the device is quite substantial when it is carrying a relatively higher current. So instantaneous power losses is higher. Okay. We could reduce the loss taking place in the device by connecting a snubber. Since it is a passive snubber or a lossy snubber, the losses that are taking place in the device are transferred to an external circuit and they are dissipated there. So in other words, we are not able to reduce the switching losses or the inverter losses. By connecting a snubber, we are able to reduce the losses taking place in the device. Inverter efficiency has not changed, okay, because losses have not come down. So the major limitation of a hard switch converter is that device stress is high. Di by dt and dv by dt are relatively high. So what is the reason? What is the consequence? As a consequence, the switching frequency has to be reduced. You cannot operate a hard switched converter at a very high frequency. Okay. First of all, the losses taking place in the inverter are high because it is a hard switch. As I increase the frequency, these losses also increase. So overall inverter efficiency comes down. As the losses have increased, I need to cool the inverter. So my cooling requirement or heat sink requirement has increased. So therefore, size also increases. Temperature, operating temperature has increased. Reliability comes down. Di by dt and dv by dt are very high. So these produce their own magnetic fields. So there's going to be a electromagnetic interference or EMI problems. Okay. So therefore, the switching frequency of a hard switched inverter cannot be increased above a certain range. Now you may ask, what is that range? I have no answer to that question, because it all depends on the voltage rating, the power that is handling, and the current. Because for example, MOSFET or a BJT or a IGBT, basically these are fast devices. But then it doesn't mean that I can operate IGBT at a very high frequency, you know, when the input voltage is very high and the power handled also very high. So high frequency, high voltage, high current is just not possible from a single device. In other words, as the power rating increases, I need to come down on the switching frequency. But then I have to reduce the size of the inverter, or I have to eliminate all these limitations, EMI. Your device cannot produce or affect another equipment which is kept nearby. You have to, if you have to sell your product in the international market, there are EMI regulations. So you may say that I'm ready to compromise on efficiency. Maybe, but then it cannot affect the performance of other equipment which is kept nearby. How do I eliminate these problems? You can eliminate these problems by switching the device when the voltage across it or when the current that is flowing through it is zero. I'll repeat. When the voltage across the device is zero, you turn it on. Current starts slowly rising. Voltage across the device is anyway zero. So the power loss that is taking place in the device has come down to zero approximately. Or current that is flowing through the device, somehow using an external circuit, I am controlling the di by dt. In other words, the device current that is flowing through the device as soon as I turn on is always zero. You don't have to instantaneously carry a large current. Please try to understand. When I'm saying current through the device as soon as I turned on is zero, what I mean is here. See, as soon as I turn on here, the device, whatever that current that was flowing through the inductor should flow through S. So instantaneously it will jump to the inductor, the value of the current that is flowing here. In addition, there is a recovery current, diode recovery current. So instead of having a step jump, what I'll do is I'll start increasing slowly from zero. Okay. So this class of inverters, or this sort of converters, sorry to use the word inverters, this class of converters are known as soft switched converters. Soft switched converters. See, here is the locus. See here. This is the path. Current slowly increases, voltage also falls and maybe increases here. Now it can increase at a faster rate here, no problem, because voltage across the device has already become 0 approximately to a very low value. See, the current starts rising very slowly, voltage also falls. So area under the curve has reduced now. Whereas see here, current has substantially has increased, voltage has not fallen much. So out here voltage has already fallen to a very low value, now the current increase. Similarly, while turning off, current decreases. I am not allowing the voltage to increase across the device, because by connecting some additional components, how we will see later, current decreases, but voltage has not increased. Okay. Now the voltage across the device starts increasing, but then at that time current is substantially reduced, substantially reduced. So area under this curve is very small compared to the area under this curve maybe. So what are the advantages here? Voltage across the device as well as the current flowing through the device are controlled. They are slowly increasing or decreasing. So device stress has significantly reduced. The device is switched when the voltage across it is 0 or the current through it 0. In other words, instantaneously you don't need to carry the large current. Practically, switching losses, turn on as well as turn off losses, have reduced significantly. See here, significantly. Now, device losses have reduced significantly, stress has reduced significantly. Now you can increase the switching frequency. Now if I can switch, increase the switching frequency, size comes down, size of the converter comes down. Inverter efficiency, sorry, inverter losses have come down, switching losses have come down, my cooling requirement has come down. Size has reduced. Size has reduced. But then, how am I doing all this? How am I ensuring a slow rise in current and slow rise or fall in current and voltage? Because in this circuit, it looks like everything depends on the load and the source. Whatever that was, the current that was flowing through the inductor L, when I close the switch, it has to flow through S. So I have to do some modifications in the existing circuit. Okay. But then while making the some modification, the circuit should not lose its basic character. In other words, the circuit should function as a boost converter, or because I'm showing a boost converter for most of the time. I'll repeat, for most of the time, circuit should function like a boost converter. This circuit should look like a boost converter. Only when I have to turn on or when I have to turn it off, there is a slight modification. I said I need to use some sort of a resonance technique, soft switching, or I have to create some sort of a resonance, LC resonance in the circuit. only when I have LC resonance, voltage or current starts from zero in the resonant circuit. So in addition to the existing components, I have to use separate L and separate C. By the way, what is the resonant frequency of this L and C? Or in other words, why am I doing, or why are we going for the short switching? One is I have to increase the switching frequency, therefore I have to reduce the size, therefore I can reduce the size. Also I have to reduce the switching stresses, maybe device stresses. So to reduce the size of the converter, I have to increase the switching frequency. So in other words, resonant frequency of the circuit of this LC component should be or will be very high. It could be of the order of say 500 kilohertz. Again, it depends on the power level. Please listen to me. This LC resonance circuit, the frequency could be of the order of 500 kilohertz. Let's see, if the resonant frequency is of the order of 500 kilohertz, the size of L and C becomes very small. Size of L and C becomes very small. Now I'll come back to a hard switch converter. Why are we having this as voltage spike or a current overshoot in the circuit? Most of the time the design, if you read the textbooks, it will say parasitic inductance and parasitic capacitance. Because of the parasitic inductance, we have a voltage spike. So the value of this parasitic inductance and capacitance is very small, and they affect adversely in hard switch converters. Now in soft switch converters, I want a very small L and C to create resonance. Now I can use the so-called parasitic inductance and capacitance for my advantage. See the beauty of short switching. All this overshoots are because of the parasitic inductance and capacitance. Now I can use this parasitic inductance and capacitance for my advantage for soft switching. By the way, in addition to parasitic L and C, we have to use a small L and C in the resonant converters. Okay? I'm just trying to highlight is that parasitic L and C can be used effectively in soft switching. So these are all the advantages of the soft switched converters or the resonant converters. Okay. Resonant converters. So if I switch the device when the voltage across it is 0 volts, they are known as zero voltage switched or ZVS. Instead, if the current through it is zero, they are known as zero current switched converter. If the voltage across the device is zero, it is known as zero voltage switched, or if the current is zero, it is known as zero current switched converter. More on this, I'll discuss it in the next class. Thank you.